welcome and thank you to everyone for attending. I want to begin the night's special program. If everyone could please stand for the presentation of colors by the Vietnam Veterans Inc. Following, and we'll welcome them right now, so Vietnam Veterans Inc. presenting the colors. Please remain standing for the Pledge of Allegiance. I pledge of allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. Thank you. This evening we're honored to have Bullet Bob Daly sing the national anthem here tonight. Bob, as many of you know, is a distinguished World War II veteran and also current member of the Marine Corps League South Hills Detachment. Thank you, Mr. Daly.
Oh, say can you see by the dawn's early light what so proudly we hailed at the twilight's last gleaming, whose broad stripes and bright stars through the perilous fight, o'er the ramparts we watched, were so gallantly streaming, and the rocket's red glare, the bombs bursting in air, gave proof through the night that our flag was still there. Oh, say does that star-spangled banner yet wave o'er the land of the free and the home of the brave?
Thank you. Please be seated. Welcome, distinguished guests, Vietnam War era veterans, and all veterans in attendance here tonight. It's a privilege for me to stand here today to honor, and most importantly, to thank you for your service to our country. You have sacrificed, many made the ultimate sacrifice, and deserve our eternal respect and appreciation. Although you often were not shown the due respect, upon your return, we seek to show long overdue recognition and gratitude for the tremendous sacrifice that you made for all of us. I began this effort to honor veterans with a tribute to World War II veterans, and last year we honored Korean War veterans. We will continue the effort this year and into the future to honor all of our area's distinguished servicemen and women of each conflict moving toward the present. Our great nation is no stranger to conflicts in hard-earned freedom and liberty. Steadfast and unwavering support for our troops is a lesson learned from these conflicts and must be embedded into all of our young children. Those of you here today served your country out of duty and answered the call for no other reason than it was simply the right thing to do. The tone of today's tribute is very different from some of the events of the past. Compared to some earlier veterans who came home to adoring crowds, many of you weren't properly acknowledged, and some of you even faced open hostility. Many fought to forget the hostility abroad, but faced it at home as well. Long overdue gestures of appreciation and of our sincere thanks are the minimum requirements due to you all at this point. Yet even with this adversity when you returned, you kept going and set about starting a family, creating businesses, serving in your local community as policemen and firemen, and generally working to make America a better place to live and raise a family. I am truly humbled and honored to be here with you tonight and to play some role in this in honoring you and to offer you this tribute along with the certificates and medals presented to you upon your entrance as a very small token of my thanks and the appreciation of all the people of Pennsylvania. Please know that in our minds, you are heroes now, but you have always been heroes. What remains from those years is a new understanding of the challenges you faced and renewed respect. You fought bravely and should be honored, but rather, actually, you must be honored, not just at events like this or on Veterans Day, but every single day of the year, 365 days a year. Know that we are all indebted to you for the security and freedom that we enjoy today. Thank you for your service, and may God continue to bless you, your families, and the United States of America. And I welcome you here tonight. We're going to move on to the invocation, and I'm very pleased to welcome Reverend Kevin Dominick, pastor of St. Winifred Parish in Mount Lebanon, for our opening prayer. Thank you, Reverend Dominick.
As we gather here, we turn to that God, and we remind ourselves of how that God is truly always with us every moment. God is that gift who we celebrate. This night, we also honor and give thanks to you and for the many who still need to be remembered. Most specifically, in that gift of who we are, it is that time that we gather, remembering that yesterday is history, tomorrow is the mystery, but today is the gift. And truly, we are grateful for you who have served our country, and pray for you, and pray for all who continue to work for peace. We ask this through Christ our Lord.
Thank you, Reverend Dominick. Our first speaker is not on the program, but I heard him speak at the Bethel Park Memorial event, I believe it was last year, and it was really moving, and he has a fantastic story to tell. And just a little bit about his background, I'm very proud to introduce John DeLallo, who many of you know. Mr. DeLallo is a retired Air Force Master Sergeant who served from 1968 until 1989, and spent his Vietnam years in Taiwan in theater, but not in country. His logistics group was loosely attached to the 374th Tactical Airlift Wing out of Clark Air Force Base in the Philippines and CCK Air Base on Taiwan. John's the oldest of 11 children and was the first in his generation to serve, along with his brothers Ray, Ron, and Jim. Jim relayed a story to me and to everyone at the Memorial Day event, and I think it does bear repeating, and that's why we're honored to have him and very happy to give you Master Sergeant John DeLallo, Bethel Park native and South Hills Catholic graduate of 1967.
See, for us normal size guys, these things work pretty well. Can you hear me back there? Outstanding. First of all, especially for you guys who come out, and I know you do this regularly, you attend funerals, along with the Marine Corps League, and for all of my fellow Vietnam veterans, welcome home. As Representative Smith said, the tradition of service runs rather deep in my family. My maternal grandfather fought for the Kaiser in World War I, gassed in the trenches. My dad, his brothers Al and George, they saw combat in Europe. My younger brother Jim served 4 in the Corps. Ray and Rom were National Guard, trained door gunners, but through some strange luck, never deployed. My son Matt was a Marine, 1991 to 1995. He came home with the Southwest Asia Service Medal with 3 oak leaf clusters in a year and 8 months of credible sea time. This for a boy that joined the Marines because he didn't like boats. I'm passing around a patch right now. It's a very unofficial patch, and I'm waiting for the day when my grandchildren are old enough to ask me, "Pappy, what did you do in the Vietnam War?" I found myself one day out on the ramp at CCK Air Base, just strolling around, waiting for airplanes to return from routine patrols in the Straits of Taiwan, some bombing runs up over the north, which was pretty much what we did. And I noticed a very strangely painted aircraft on the furthest end of the ramp. So I asked my buddy, seasoned aircraft mechanic, "Hey, what kind of C-130 is that?" He said, "There's no C-130. I said, "No, that one out there." He said again, "There's no C-130. So I pressed him, and he told me that the aircraft didn't exist. Forget I ever saw it. And he was actually pretty stern about it. The patch that I'm passing around right now is unofficial and it's unapproved. It was developed by some pretty brave guys who flew into Hanoi to set up the navigational aids for the C-141 aircraft that were to follow shortly and fly our released POWs home. It's just another example of the bravery and the unquestioned devotion to duty, honor, country, exhibited by our nation's finest. Again, my grandkids haven't asked me, "What'd you do in the Vietnam War, Pappy?" Can't wait to tell them about the C-130 that doesn't exist. Thank you all. Thank you for coming. And I salute each and every one of you. You are heroes. I am not, but I have the absolute honor of having served in a company of heroes.
Thank you, Mr. DeLallo. And I don't know how I did this, but I actually skipped over inadvertently the man who makes all of Bethel Park happen, and who we were honored to recognize last year as a Korean War veteran at our Korean War event, Mayor Cliff Morton, for some opening remarks as well.
Thank you, and welcome everyone. I know there's a lot of folks here who don't live in Bethel Park, but believe me, we welcome you anytime you want to come into town. You can come in and use our restaurants and whatever else you want to do here. Thank you for that. And I was thinking, as the first speaker was talking about Vietnam, and during those years, being a Korean vet, I, of course, wasn't in the military at the time. But I kept hearing what was going on in the news, and my heart ached every time we had the Hawks and the and the Dubs squabbling down in Washington, half of them thinking the war was the worst thing in the world, and the other one thinking it was necessary, and it just went on and on and on. And then to treat you fellas and gals the way they did when you came home was just really heartening to me. It was just a sad thing. But welcome all you vets. Thank you for the service. Regardless of what war you were in, thank you for that. And I'm sure you're going to get some good words from the speakers to follow, and so I'll stop with that. And again, welcome and enjoy the evening.
Thank you, Mayor. Now I want to bring up someone who I think has addressed the audience at all of our veterans events. This will be his third time, and you know, it's always an honor for me to have this speaker come to these events because of his experience, because of what he's done for this country, and because he speaks in such a way from the heart. And I think it's just very special. And I just want to tell you a little bit about our next speaker, David McCulloch's background. Dave is the past commandant of South Hills Detachment Number 726 of the Marine Corps League and past commander of the American Legion Post 760 in Bethel Park. Dave served as a corpsman in the U.S. Navy, where he was attached to the 1st Battalion, 3rd Marines, and was the recipient of the Purple Heart. Currently, Dave serves as a member of the Bethel Park Veterans Memorial Committee, where he's done some amazing work at Bethel Park's Veterans Memorial right across the street. And he's also a volunteer for BPTV. With that, I'm very honored to bring up Dave McCulloch as our next speaker.
I know Dave Cable knows I don't volunteer too much anymore, so if he's still here, I'm sorry, Dave. Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. I want to thank Representative Smith for, again, inviting me to speak to a group of veterans that I happen to be a member of. I am a combat veteran of the Vietnam War, and as Representative Smith said, I was a corpsman attached to the 1st Battalion, 3rd Marines from 1966. Listen to me, 1967, 1968 in Vietnam. I was honored 3 years ago, as he just said, at the World War II Veterans Appreciation Day. And I remember standing at the day I said day and looking out at the crowd and thinking to myself, boy, these guys look old. And then again, last year at the Korean War Veterans, I looked out in the crowd and I said, my goodness, these guys look old too. But here today is a veteran of the Vietnam War, and except for myself, as I look out there today, boy, you guys look old. Jeez. A friend of mine recently asked if when I went to Vietnam, if anything surprised me. And I started laughing. I said, surprise me? Everything surprised me. I could write a book. I just turned 18. I didn't know of anything. I was a kid like every other kid, or a lot of the kids today. I didn't watch the news. I was playing baseball or football. I never heard of Vietnam. So I started telling her a couple things that did surprise me. And when I was stationed at Camp Pendleton, I volunteered to be stationed overseas at Okinawa. And when I got to Okinawa, we were in formation out on the grinder, and the sergeant said, is anybody here not going to Vietnam tomorrow? Well, I proudly raised my hand because I had my orders. I volunteered for Okinawa. And he came over and took my orders. He looked at him and it says, Oda, you're going to Vietnam. I said, Vietnam, my sergeant, it says Okinawa. He said, headquarters company's Okinawa. Dave McCulloch, Vietnam. So that was my first surprise, I guess. My second surprise was being a lily-white, fair-haired Irish boy from Pittsburgh stepping off the aircraft onto the tarmac in Da Nang with 125 degrees and 98% humidity, and the air was sucked out of my lungs. It was like walking into a pizza oven, and it's just something I could never explain to anyone. It was just, well, except for the folks here that were there. So, but at that time, that was horrible. Then I got there a little too late to join my company. They were in the field, so they put me in a transient tent. And I'm going to be straight up with you. I'm going to be honest with you. I didn't know anything about anything. So I'm laying on my cot in the transient tent, and I hear four violent explosions. And I got stunned, and I moved to the edge of the cot. And a couple minutes later, there's four violent explosions again. I lay down on the dirt. And about that time, the tent flap opened, and two or three guys come walking. They said, what are you doing? I said, I don't know where those explosions are. I don't know where the bunkers are. He said, that's outgoing artillery. What are you doing? So I had to bear the embarrassment of that for the rest of the evening and the next day. So the next day was probably my biggest surprise when I got lifted out to the company, and I was met by the sergeant at the helicopter, and he took me and introduced me to the platoon sergeant, who took me and introduced me to the skipper. And then I went to the side, and they said, okay, you're going to dig your fighting hole here. So being a knowledgeable war veteran at this time, having 11-hour service in the country, I went over like any fair-haired Irishman from Pittsburgh that never experienced heat over 80 degrees. I took my shirt off and adjusted my E-tool and started digging my foxhole. My next conscious memory was about 25 minutes later, as two people were escorting me half conscious over to the medic tent because I had second-degree burn blisters on my fair white back, and I was heat exhausted. And as they were treating my first war injuries, I heard the corpsman say to me, he says, well, you're lucky you're new here because you'd be court-martialed for malingering. And that's the first time my name was ever put in association with the word court-martial. Much like some young people today, I had no idea of events. And just very briefly, I want to name a couple other things that actually surprised me when I was in Vietnam. Hueys. I never heard of Hueys. I never saw a Huey. And we were being pinned down at a burial mound. We're getting some pretty heavy fire from a village. And my friend was beside me at this mound, and a Huey helicopter come over, and he said, have no fear, Huey's here. And I'm thinking to myself, what could a helicopter do for us? And then about that time, he fired about three rocket, Willie Peter rockets. The hooch blew up that they were firing, that big white smoke fire. Oh, that's what he meant. There's weapons on these helicopters. I never knew that either. I was with the Marines. We were on CH-34s. They're the ones that look like the big grasshoppers. Another thing I know most of you will agree with me with, especially the infantry, the Army, and the Marines. I like sea rations. I really liked them. We had the 1954 series of sea rations, and my fame was that I liked the ham and lima beans, which apparently nobody else did, because when we passed our sea rations out, they'd line up in front of me to trade my cocoa for their ham and lima beans, which I had a recipe for, by the way. And I was actually thinking about opening a sea rash diner when I got out, but That all went to pieces. And I certainly was not prepared and was surprised as a Navy corpsman that I would get amoebic dysentery because I did not put the iodine tablets in the canteen, which, by the way, was the second time I heard my name associated with the word court-martial. John DiLallo and Mr. Smith had said a couple things, and Mayor Morton, it was an ugly time. The Vietnam War, the first TV war. And the citizens of this country weren't prepared for what they saw. Unlike the movies and TV series on the time, real combat is a gut-wrenching experience. So with grainy news footage and slanted storylines, all these, mostly students, were with absolutely no expertise in anything, went out to the streets to protest and portrayed themselves as experts in foreign affairs and combat. And who did they find to be their biggest fans and admirers? The North Vietnamese military and communists everywhere. And who paid the price for their misguided efforts? The American warrior. The American warrior and their allies who were sent to do a job, protect an ally, and make it safe for the threatened peoples of that region. We served as a beacon of hope for the entire world to see. We unselfishly stood up while others turned their backs. We took up the mantle of freedom and unselfishly departed from our comfort zones to look out for the less fortunate. We did honorable deeds. In America, the reason for going to war is always honorable. It's only hindsight and demagogues that criticize the decision makers. We don't conquer nations, enslave peoples, take lands, or treasure. We historically protect our best interest, restore liberty to those that have may never tasted freedom in their lives, and in so doing, try to make the world a better place. Warriors do that, not reporters, not politicians, not protesters. Warriors. We stand between good and evil, always. H.L. Mencken wrote, there is always an easy solution to every human problem, neat, plausible, and wrong. We don't do easy problems. If there were an easy way to avoid a war, I would ask a soldier to make that decision to avoid war. A combat veteran, someone that has experienced the carnage of war. The American soldier, sailor, Marine, and airman are always victorious because we stand for freedom, we stand for justice, we stand for a culture and a society that has been blessed by God. We have always been a powerful nation that has overcome great hardships and injustices of our own. We are a beacon for peace and freedom in the whole world, and that beacon is represented by the United States military. In Vietnam, we saw that in the faces of the people, especially the children. When we were in villages doing med caps, on patrol on the roads, and in the streets of Vietnam. They saw a beacon of light in each of us, a glimmer of hope that they one day would live in a country as free, as rich, and as wonderful as the United States. There are no peoples anywhere on this planet risking their lives crossing the border to get into Russia, Iran, Pakistan, Venezuela, or any other place for that matter. Only the United States experiences this phenomenon. The media of this country always finds someone to put in front of their cameras to insult and denounce the United States. But turn that camera off and give that person, that same person, the opportunity to come to this country, and he'll be here in a heartbeat. Like many of you here today, I am a proud warrior, a Vietnam veteran. And I'm proud of all you here today, just as I'm proud of all who have served this country in 235 plus years. I'm proud that I stepped up to serve my country when asked, and I still believe our cause was just and honorable. Yes, I'm proud of my service, and as many have said before, I know that I'm no hero, but I've walked with heroes. I know of my experience in Vietnam, and I refuse to have anybody define my role except for that of another veteran. May the good Lord bless all those here today, our President, Congress, and all the troops in harm's way. But most importantly, may God continue to bless the greatest country in the world, the United States of America. Thank you.
Thank you, Dave. I greatly appreciate your service to this country and for coming when we ask you to come and share some of your thoughts. Thank you very much. Our last guest speaker I'm very proud to have here as well is Reverend Daniel Valentine, pastor of the St. James Parish in Sewickley. Father Valentine is a Bethel Park native and ordained priest for the Diocese of Pittsburgh. He served three parishes as a parochial vicar before becoming a chaplain in the United States Navy. Father Valentine served in the Marine Corps on active duty in Okinawa, Korea, Beaufort, MCRD San Diego, as well as with the United Nations Expedition in Turkey. His service earned him the Navy Commendation Medal. Father Valentine goes beyond his pastoral responsibilities to serve on several interfaith organizations and initiatives. He is chaplain for the 36th District and served for 2 years as the department chaplain of the American Legion. He also serves as chaplain for the Knights of Columbus at St. James Parish. And I'm very pleased, that's just a sampling of some of his achievements and credentials, and I'm very pleased to be joined by Father Daniel Valentine here today. Come on up, Father.
Well, good evening. For me, it's like coming home. I grew up here in Bethel. But before this began, I'm standing beside Bob Daly, and he said, boy, I hope the speakers are short. And I meant, you probably meant my height, right? Okay. I said, Bob, it's going to be just like Sunday. And of course, I got a groan out of him. I told him, I said, I'm on vacation. And I'm traveling down from Ligonier, and if you know what my driving skills are like, I mean, I can get lost in my parking lot. So I'm the owner of a GPS, and I want you to know I'm the only one that has a Garmin that cusses at me. I make so many dumb mistakes. Now, I don't know why my garment took me the way it did tonight. It took me right down Route 88, past my old homestead where I grew up. I remember walking that road all my life. It was 1954 when my family moved here. It wasn't even called Bethel Park, it was Bethel Township. Down in 88, there was nothing. I remember the Shetland Pony, a bar. I remember Sharon's, a very small store. Where I grew up off of King School Road, there was nothing. Sam Tischer had just built three homes. My dad, who was part of the great generation of World War II veterans, a Marine Corps veteran, purchased a home on Horseshoe Drive. And this would be the place where I would grow up. All my life, I was teethed on the Marine Corps anthem. We learned all the protocol and everything about being in the Marine Corps. I remember as I grew up, there was one thing I always wanted to do, was to make my dad proud of me. And one of the things in my heart from an early age was I wanted to be a priest. And I remember the date exactly, as I remember 1954, when I moved here to Bethel. In a remote part of the world called Indochina, later on we would refer to it as Vietnam, there were things that were happening that were going to set the stage, which eventually will bring us to a crossroad and even connect us in this meeting tonight. The year for me was 1969, December 1st. I was a divinity student. I was close to graduating from Duquesne University. December 1st, 1969 was when they reinstituted the draft. And for the first time in American history, the way this draft, the Selective Service, would select men and women to serve the country was by birth dates. And they would pull capsules. And inside each capsule was a birth date. Now, again, if you knew my life, if it wasn't for bad luck, I'd have no luck. I'm sitting there studying that night, and I'm listening to the radio. First capsule, September 14th. You know what my birthday is? September 14th. But I was deferred because I was a divinity student. And then it began happening. Friends, buddies of mine that I went to school with at Bethel High School, they came back in body bags. I made a promise to myself. It was like a vow that only I can make between myself and God. That if I ever had the chance to serve in the military, I would. Well, the way it works with us priests, you have to be a priest for 10 years. Well, I was 35 by the time they released me. I'm an old fart at this point. Everybody else in boot camp were 18, 19 years old. I thought I was dying. Then I prayed to die. And for us chaplains, you have to, we don't know who we're going to be chosen to serve. It could be the Navy, it could be the Marine Corps, it could be the Coast Guard. So we waited and waited, and halfway through boot camp, I was selected to go with the Marines. Now, what was unusual about my career was the fact that usually after you serve with the Marines, they put you with the Coast Guard or Navy. I never got out of the Marine Corps. Honest to God, I think they thought I was damaged. But little did I realize how much my life would change and how I was stretching beyond the limits of Bethel, Bethel Park, beyond the limits of Pittsburgh, and even this country of ours that you spoke so eloquently. I agree with what you said, David. It'd be years and years later that I would end up in Okinawa as well. And I don't know what it is. You know, being called Reverend, I'm not used to that. I can hear my mother, Reverend. That's hardly a term she would use to describe me. But in the Marine Corps, what do they call the priests? Padre. So everybody calls you Padre. And for some reason, I always ended up connected with Marines that had gone wrong. As chaplain at the Nauvoo prison. Anyone going to the brig, I was the one that would go, they'd call me to go see. There was one particular fellow. His name was Tom. He was in deep trouble. He was drinking too much. Way too much. In fact, the night before, they found him in the gutter. They had to scoop him up out of the gutter. And he was on the verge of going to the brig. So they called me as one last ditch effort. Father, please talk to Tom. He's a good Marine. And so I remember the day that I went to visit him. I took a deep breath. I didn't know what to expect. I can remember walking into the room, and he stood at attention, saluted me, saluted him back. And I said, I hear you're in trouble, Tom. He said, yes, I am, and I don't want to talk about it. And I said, why is that? He said, because first, I hate priests, and second, I hate officers. I said, oh boy, here we go. And I said, listen, you're going to the brig. If you keep up the way you're going, your life's going to be destroyed. He began to tell me a saga, and actually the pattern of which was playing out in my own life, and it was a pattern that probably plays out in the lives of many of us. One of the reasons why I wanted to spend a few minutes just speaking with you about who we're honoring tonight. I never realized the deep rippling effects of that Vietnam War. In fact, we wouldn't even call it war. Everybody's calling it conflict. It was a war. As I stood there listening to this guy, the story he told me blew me away. He was an American Indian, Native American Indian. And when he was 6 years old, he remembers his brother volunteering to go in the Marine Corps. He's in Vietnam 3 months, and he's shot. And he comes back in a body bag. And according to the Prairie Indian, the ritual that they follow, they must bury him out in the prairie. And they take his horse that Tom had often accompanied his brother out in the prairie. But the ritual amongst this tribe of Indians was they buried the body, they would shoot the horse of the fallen warrior. No one could ride that horse again. And he says, a six-year-old boy, I watched that as they lowered the coffin in the ground. And they went up with a pistol and shot the horse between the eyes. He spared no detail. And he said, Father, that's when I took my first drink. He said, I've been drinking ever since. He said, after my brother was buried, the second oldest son volunteered to go to the Marine Corps. And off he went after boot camp. He made it 6 months in Vietnam. His body came back. But the American government explained that they shouldn't open up the body bag because he had been mutilated. His body had been cut into 100 pieces. But the father insisted he wanted to see his son. Now, as a 7-year-old, he can remember that moment when they opened the coffin. And he said to me, and I drank, and I drank, and I made a promise myself that someday I would go back and get revenge for my brothers. I must take up the honor of my family name. I want to make my dad proud of me. Well, by the time he was old enough to go to boot camp, Vietnam was over. But the effects of Vietnam lingered on. That's why when I watched the kinds of things that you were describing, it was a national disgrace, the way we treated our Vietnam veterans. And I could see the rippling effect in this young boy called Tom. Life shattered. But son after son after son, many of which was repeated all across this land, they were offered up, given away, in terms of causes that we believed were good. And now at this moment in time, I'm sitting there talking with Tom. And as the story unfolded, as he went into all the details, my head was spinning, I was blown away. I can remember as we parted, I stood up and I said, Tom, with all the things that you faced, the things that you dealt with, I remember putting my hand on his shoulder. I said, any dad would be proud of you, boy. Semper Fi, and that's code for Marines. Always faithful. Now, I got off active duty way back in 87, and I keep thinking about Tom, where he is and whatever happened to him. I think about his brothers, Tom's dad. I can't help but think about the kinds of things that connect our lives. And why tonight is so terribly important, because we've never acknowledged that rippling effect, how it paralyzed a nation, how it affected all of us. Last 6 years of my dad's life, because I always wanted to please him, I wanted him to be proud of me. I can remember as he was laying there dying, hooked up to an oxygen machine, I can remember him trying to talk to me one of the last times. I could hear him gasping. He said, "Danny, Danny." And I jumped off the floor where I was laying. I put my ear down by his ear. He said, "Danny, I'm proud of you." Then I saw a tear go down his cheek. His last words, "Semper Fi." My last word to him, "Semper Fi, Dad." And to all the veterans that are here, you've been faithful. You're our warriors, and we are proud. And the country is a better country because of the sacrifices that you made. And I'm so proud to be able to have this opportunity to say that. Semper Fi, always faithful to the end. Men, women, Vietnam veterans, thank you.
Thank you, Father Valentine. That was tremendous. Would all of our Vietnam vets please stand right now? We're going to do the medal presentation, and I want to just say quickly, we honor you on this day, as we should every day, as I said. But you know, this is just a small token of my appreciation, of every resident of the Commonwealth's appreciation for what you've done for this country. So I hereby confer upon you this medal on behalf of the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania in recognition of your service to this nation during the Vietnam era. Please place the medal around your neck at this time. Congratulations, and most importantly, thank you. Just before we show the video, as Father Valentine was speaking, the thought occurred to me about what he mentioned, and I think what he described as the rippling effect. And you know, I want all the veterans to know there's certainly nothing that we can do or that my generation can do to right the wrongs that were done to you when you returned from that faraway place. But do take solace in the knowledge that, you know, my generation looks at it, and I think there's a combination of anger and confusion and not really understanding to some extent, because I didn't grow up in that era, how you could be treated the way that you were treated when you returned. And you know, as I said, there's nothing that can be said or done to right all those wrongs, but I hope that you take some comfort in the idea that my generation, to a person, I believe, would never do that to the servicemen and women who are returning from Iraq or Afghanistan, would never have done it in that context, and as I said, remained confused, angry. I think a lot of emotions go through people my age wondering how that could have happened and why that could have happened. But I hope that you do take comfort, as I said, in knowing that that's not something that this generation believes. And perhaps even most importantly, when I talk to my daughters and my son about what you did, and not only the Vietnam vets, but the World War II vets, the Korean War veterans, the Vietnam veterans, the Iraq War veterans, the Afghanistan War veterans, what all of you have done for this country. And I hope you take, as I said, some comfort in knowing that we will pass on the sacrifice and the recognition of what you've done for all of us in preserving our freedom to the next generation and the next generation after that. So I hope that, as I said, you take some comfort there. We can't right all the wrongs, but we certainly will make every effort. And as I said, you know, I think it's important to recognize and to live every day by not just recognizing what you've done at events like this or on Veterans Day or Memorial Day for the fallen, but recognize it every single day. So I just wanted to make sure I communicated that as well. Thank you. We're going to show a short video now that serves as a tribute and thank you to all the veterans of the Vietnam War. And please know that we all share the sentiment expressed in this song and that we truly do owe the freedom and benefits of life today in this great country, as Dave said, the greatest country on the face of the earth, that we recognize that we owe all of that to the sacrifices that you all made. So this video is called Before You Go.
Quietly you've all turned gray. You did your job, you saved our way. Our lives of freedom you preserved. We thanked you less than you deserved. You never boasted, bragged or asked for adulation for your past. You sacrificed your youth to war. We owe you more. We owe you more. Thank you for your wondrous peace, for open speech and quiet streets, for worship as we choose to pray, for preservation of our way. You leave us blessed with every breath that cost you arms and legs and death. You did the job you knew was right, and silently you cry at night for bodies maimed and comrades lost, for sights beyond our furthest thoughts, for what you've lived and felt and seen, for what the cost of freedom, freedom means. Before you go, we need to show that in your silence we still know what you accomplished and what you and sons and daughters for a job well done, from kids who've never seen a tank. We give you thanks, we give you thanks. Thank you for your wondrous speech, for open speech and quiet streets, for worship as we choose to pray, for preservation of our way, for homes and jobs and baseball games, for many colors, many names. You saved our lives and we're still free, from shining seas to shining sea.
closing thank yous and remarks before we start the reception. I want to make sure that, as many of you know, an event like this is literally months in the making. And I want to make sure I thank my tremendous staff, Bill Moore, Kathy Wolf, Lauren Hurley, our interns, Christopher McCabe, who I don't think was able to make it tonight, Shannon Boisseau, who's in the back there, was able to make it tonight. Thank you, Shannon. Want to also thank our photographer, Bill Pokolnik. I really appreciate all your work. This is something that takes literally months to put together. Want to thank the municipality of Bethel Park, Mayor Morton, Dave Cable with BPTV, and all the staff of BPTV and the Bethel Park School District as well. I want to make sure I acknowledge a few of our elected officials in the audience tonight. Councilman Jim Hannon from Bethel Park was with us earlier. He had to leave. Councilman Mark Samponia from Greentree is with us. Councilman Jack Allen from Bethel Park is with us. And County Councilman Mike Finnerty is also with us. I want to make sure we give them a round of applause. Thank you. And one final note on Bethel Park is, as many of you know, Dave is, as I said, is a member of the Bethel Park Veterans Committee, Memorial Committee, and Councilman Jim McClain and Councilman Mark O'Brien have done tremendous work through the committee in locating Bethel Park natives who were killed during the Vietnam War, and they're going to have a special ceremony, I know, at next year's Memorial Day festivities, adding another Bethel Park native to the memorial. So I think, I just want to make sure that I acknowledge the work that the committee has done through Jim McClain and Mark O'Brien in locating Bethel Park residents who have paid the ultimate sacrifice. So just tremendous work by them. And lastly, I want to again welcome Reverend Kevin Dominic, pastor of St. Winifred Parish, for the benediction. Thank you, Reverend.
This evening has been words of memories, words of thanks. But most especially, we cannot do it without that God. So for three reasons. First, thanking all of you. Taking a moment and remembering those whose lives were lost. And remembering the many who continue to work and still provide that freedom that you have provided for. We do thank God. And we ask that God continue to bless us, bless those who have gone before us, and most especially, bless that gift of who we are, children of God, as we work together. We ask this through Christ our Lord. Amen.
Thank you, Reverend. We're going to begin retiring of the colors. Would you please stand for the retiring of the colors by Vietnam Veterans, Inc. of Pittsburgh. Thank you very much. And just a few last housekeeping matters. I hope everyone will be able to join all of our distinguished guests, our veterans, my staff and me for light refreshments. And as you make your way to the back of the room, please visit the table for Army Strong Center located in Coriopolis and dedicated to improving the lives of veterans. Heather Uphold, Customer Support Coordinator, is here to provide you with more information on the organization. And also Carol Habercheck is here tonight representing the Vietnam Veterans Memorial Fund. She has information about the Education Center at the Wall, and the call for photos. Please visit her table in the back as well. And some of you know I sponsored a resolution in the House a couple weeks ago supporting the efforts of the Vietnam Veterans Memorial Fund. They're working to construct the education center down at the wall for future generations, as I said, for my kids, for their kids, to learn about the honor and sacrifices made by those who have heroically served during the Vietnam War. The resolution's going to pass, and what the resolution does is recommend to the Congress that they provide funding for the education center. So, as I said, I hope everyone can stick around for refreshments. One final note, I do want to announce Mr. McGarvey, I think, is still here. He's been very involved with the Upper St. Clair Veterans Memorial. They're actually going to break ground on the Veterans Memorial in Upper St. Clair, dedicate the memorial in Upper St. Clair on Veterans Day, November 11th. Of 2011, next week. That memorial will be dedicated. It's located right next to the township building, if you're familiar with the Upper St. Clair Township building. So I wanted to make sure I put that in there as well. And I invite all the veterans and their families to have commemorative photos taken over near the Pennsylvania and American flags as well. And again, just want to thank all of you for coming out tonight, letting us honor you in this way. I know that, as I said earlier, in many ways, this is not, in talking to some of the Vietnam vets I talked with over the last couple months, it's not the easiest thing in the world for some folks. So I appreciate everyone who made it out tonight. And again, most importantly, thank you from all of us for the sacrifice that you provided for our freedom. Thank you very much.